We're going to go ahead and introduce everyone, and then we're going to move on to some of our topics, which include RigTune, starting, stuff to look out for while you're on the race course, some boat handling, and then again, at the very end, we're going to deal with any questions that you have and provide as many answers. Again, if there's a question that's asked along the way that's relevant to what we're talking about and can seamlessly include it, we'll do that while we're in flight. So today, joining myself here, I'm the manager here in Quanta Sales Cleveland. I've sailed in the Thistle class for many years, and I have a former national champion in the Thistle class and a few other classes as well, Allan Terhune, as well as one of our good friends from the South, Greg Griffin, who's a Quantum Sales on the Circuit rep, and Greg has sailed in the Thistle class for many, many years. So very happy to have these guys on board with us. I'm going to be the moderator. I'm going to present each topic as best as I can and then kick it to either Allan or Greg to provide some more in-depth commentary. And they both know if they can find a point that they can think of to add to the topic while we're discussing it, they're more than welcome to pitch in whenever they can. So we're going to go ahead and get started. And our first topic category is going to be RigTune. Ultimately trying to perfect the shape of speed, so to speak. And the first and foremost, what we want to talk about, what a lot of Thistlers talk about every time we go to regattas, you'll see everybody with their mask down before the event, tuning their rig, tweaking their diamonds, and adjusting their halyard length, rig, etc. So ultimately, the goal here is to tune your mast to match this mainsail's luff curve and the sailing style of the team. The class is a little different because we use diamonds up and down the mast versus other classes that use spreaders, that we have upper and lower shrouds. So ultimately, it's the lower and middle diamonds that are adjusted to maintain the mainsail's luff curve, and then the upper diamond is going to be adjusted basically according to your crew weight or your sailing style. So, Allan, I'm going to go ahead and kick this one over to you to talk about a few more points in regards to how you would basically set up a Thistle mast to match the design of the luff curve for any given set of sails that a sailor might be using.
Thanks. Well, most of the tuning guides are pretty accurate now with the diamond tensions. For me, it's more of a visual thing and what I see in the boat from when I go sailing. So, I was looking through some of my past notes today and going through it. But, for me, it's really setting the boat up, go put the boat in the water and just see every mast kind of bends a little bit differently. And the one thing I'm always looking for is just even bend, especially up to where the hounds attach, so your bottom two diamonds. And then the top diamond for me, the real thing there is I want the top of the mast to bend regardless of crew weight. If the mast at the top is too stiff, the upper leech gets hooked too quickly and you can't trim hard enough. So for me, I like to see the mast be a little bendy. So I always was on the looser side of the diamonds on the top, kind of regardless. So, but again, it's kind of just to keep a fair amount of mast bend. When I'm doing it. So, I'm not even looking at the, I would say luff curve of the main as much as just keeping, go and sight the mast and making sure there's not any odd bumps or protrusions on the rig when we're sailing. But I think all of them are kind of in that range, being in the, 8, 10, 5 kind of category, tuning wise, or, 7, 10, 5, bottom to top. Always seemed to work pretty well. I was always, depending on which sails I used, the bottom two diamonds in the middle of the range, but always on the looser ones on the top. That was just my own personal preference, as I like to hear it bend. But that was the big thing for me.
And in regards to the top diamond being a little looser, yeah, and using some more mass bend on top, what exactly are you going for? Why exactly would you do that? Is it like how you like the sail, how you like to trim the main, like?
For me, it was more of if the mast was too stiff, I felt like the leeches wanted to shut down too early. So for me, I always wanted the mast up there to bend and kind of keep the upper leech twisting open so I could keep trimming harder. without stalling the top too quickly. I think one of the things that happens is when the mast gets too stiff, you always, you know, you run the risk of having to ease in order to get the top of the main to open up. So, for me, it's, you know, kind of the critical thing. I think the more critical tuning dimension is really your rake measurement and the shroud tensions versus the diamonds. Because I think, you know, the diamonds are a little, to me, I think they're not as crucial if you're on the tuning guide as the other two, or shimming. But to me, I just always went top looser on the range at the top just so that the top of the mast would open up for me. And then I'm sure everybody else does it differently. But
on the shroud, you basically stick to the recommendations from the tuning guide then?
It's funny, kind of one of my things that I've always felt is, the rake measurement was always in that, 27-foot range, right around there on the, well, at least the Great Midwest I had. But to me, the forestay, I would generally, as soon as we were hiking, we definitely would be on the tighter end of the range. And then if we were in the boat, we maybe loosened up a turn or so, but generally we always felt good with the mast, with the shrouds tight. And, and then if we needed to, we shimmed to do some other things, but we never really felt good when the rig was super loose. So, anytime we erred on the tight side, we always felt better, at least for me. But, I think the rake measurement is the crucial one.
Yeah. And you saw the, proper tension of the shrouds basically while you're sailing. You can actually see the lower, whether it's going slack or not, or the leeward shroud going slack or not.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm.
And then this is kind of a real quick question for both Greg and Allan. It's kind of a debate that goes on in the Thistle class a lot, depending on what type of sails you have or the mast. But I'd say, thoughts on shave step versus flat step, or is it really just whatever you can do to induce the proper amount of mast bend to set the sail up correctly?
Can I take that one?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Greg.
Yeah, so I think Allan touched on that, all masts are not created equal. And so getting the amount of bend so that the sail sets up is really important. And I sail a shave step, so I'm actually running a tighter set of tensions than Allan described. And I really like to have the shave step because that allows me to set up the main with some pre-bend to start with. I can achieve pre-bend when I set the rig up, and I'm looking for 2.5 inches, usually somewhere in that ballpark, with a tension of about 32 on the forestay, 31 usually on that old style loose gauge. And what that then does is I end up a little bit tighter on the tensions. I'm 12 at the bottom, 15 in the middle, and then I even tried as much as 8 last weekend, sailing a little heavier, sailing about 470 with the people. So what I've been able to do is be able to sail 2-man. If I don't have a third on a lake, the sail sets up real nice, and I can flatten it very quickly having that shave step. And then when I get into some big lump, like we had the beginning of the year, midwinters and the Orange Peel Regattas, where you've got a lot of chop and you actually need power and breeze, we'll throw a shim in the front, which is much easier to throw a shim in the front of the mast than it is to get one pried back. And so I use shimming to add power up as opposed to depower. So I start with the shave step, which depowers very quickly.
Okay, excellent. That's great feedback. Any other comments in regards to mast dynamics? And ultimately, I would think the way I think about it in regards to following the tuning guides, regardless of what style of sails you're using, they always do a great job of getting everybody in the ballpark 90% of where you need to be. And then the one thing I always tell people is then just go out and sail and get some feedback, find out what works for you and what doesn't, and make adjustments accordingly. Copy the other fast guys, go ahead and ask them questions. Obviously, if you see Allan, Greg, or myself, or anybody else out there that's going fast, ask them questions and figure out what they're doing. And I think, it'll get you, the tuning guides get you there 90%, and then it's based upon sailing style and feedback on the race course. All right, let's move on to the next topic in hand. We're going to talk about controlling the draft a little bit. And this is where basically the draft or the main sail, I like to call it the go pedal. It's what makes the sail go fast in my mind. And depending on the velocity and some other dynamics, you know, that are going on in regards to how you trim, et cetera, you're ultimately going to need to control the placement of the draft by adjusting one or more of the control lines on the boat. That would be the outhaul, you know, which is used to control the depth of the draft. The Cunningham, which is used to control the location, fore and aft location of the draft. And then the Boomvang, which is used to maintain the shape of the mainsail. And also in the mast end when you're fully trimmed in. So one of the guys I love to watch on the race course, and I know Greg does a good job of adjusting his control lines because he has his boat set up to be you know, powered up in almost all conditions. So Greg, we're going to let you take this one and just give us an idea of, you know, kind of how you go through the process of adjusting your control lines to get exactly what you want. And maybe, you know, kind of give us an example of lighter air setup, medium air setup, and then heavy air setup.
Sure thing. So one thing, the Quorum main is cut with the max length lug. And I have an adjustable main hired, which allows me to get it all the way up for upwind sailing. And then what you need to do is make sure there's a slug at the tack area, and you need to make sure you have that pulled down as far as it will go, because as the mast starts to bend, it will try and bunch and slide out at the feeding area where you've got the cutout in the rig. So it's in the mast, the back of the mast there, the slot. So it's really important to get that slug all the way tugged down to, as a starting point, and then it's going to set up the bottom of the main much better as you go through those adjustments. So as the sail starts to bend, the mast starts to bend a lot. One thing I find, if we're in more of a puffy condition and we're vane sheeting, we're going to actually start pulling on the Cunningham a little bit. And you can see in this picture, there's some really nice overbend wrinkles there. I don't know if my cursor is showing you that. There we go. See that. You can see those overbend wrinkles coming front to back. And when you start getting into a depower situation, I will actually start pulling a lot of those out to pull the draft back forward. And you can see the draft here is in a great spot. This is a little lighter air, I would expect, because of the overbend wrinkles look nice and thick. But the draft is still, the max draft is still about 45% or less, maybe 40%. And so that's going to be my goal looking at the sail, is using that Cunningham to pull it back forward as we go into the upper range of breeze, and the mast starts to bend a lot. It tends to work its way back. Both the wind pushes it back and the bend of the mast will shift that draft out. As backing back up to the outhaul part, one thing is the Quorum main is really nice response to the outhaul. So when you need power, you can actually go off on the outhaul a little bit more and batten up the bottom part of the sail. And I may even ease it where that, you know, the shelf closes. Usually in lighter air, I'm going to close the shelf to flatten the sail a little bit more down low, because the wind going around the outside of the sail tends to detach towards the leak as soon as you've got too fat of a sail or too deep of a draft. So we'll pull it on a little tighter in lighter air, and then if we get into some lump and medium air, we're probably going to be actually easing to put some more power back into it. And it's very responsive to that outhaul. So I find that I may have that shelf actually open, and maybe you're looking at the sail, the depth of the sail hanging over the squareness of the boom on the side a little bit. It's open that much if I need a lot of power. And then as the wind starts to really come back on, I may come back on with that outhaul a little bit more to reduce the power. Especially in flat water, you can get away with the outhaul fairly tight in flat water and breeze. And then finally, the boom bang, as as we start to get overpowered and we're all three fully hiked or two fully hiked, depending on whether you're sailing two or three, but once you get to that point where you are starting to get overpowered and you need to depower, we will pull the boom thing on a bit, and that will force the boom forward, actually, and create more lower mass bend in the sail, which, again, that's going to depower down low. And it's also going to keep the leech tight so that when we ease the main, take the boat flat in a puff, that we aren't spilling too much of the leech off and losing our height. So the boom vang is very useful for that that vang cheating technique, and we've really enjoyed the ability to use that to depower the sail. The quan man responds very well to vang cheating. So I'll pitch that to Allan to add his thoughts.
Yeah, I mean, I think you've covered it. I mean, I think the one thing just to remember is really, as you mentioned, you know, the outhaul is really affects the bottom, you know, third of the sail. I would say, you know, as you get up above, it's more of a rig tuning situation. So, you know, just keeping in mind when, you know, you're making outhaul adjustments, really driving, you know, bottom quarter, bottom third of the sail, you know, kind of your depth and shaping there. And I think, you know, one thing to err on to be careful is if you ease too much outhaul off, you end up with too much return in the bottom of the main there, and the boom ends up stalling that way too. So there's a fine balance of how much you can ease. And I would say, you know, probably your range of, you know, tensions are probably all the way out to, you know, maybe 2 inches in from the band is probably your max range of how much you're easing or moving the outhaul, and no more than that. Because, you know, you see a common mistake, people keep easing it. And you never want to see wrinkles coming away from the boom, you know, perpendicular to the boom into the sail. That means the outhaul is just way too loose. And you do see that from time to time, for sure.
That's a great point, Allan. Little bit goes a long way in that ease. It doesn't take much to put a lot of depth back into the bottom.
Yeah, for sure.
Awesome. Thanks, guys. And then before we move on to the next topic, probably as somebody who sails in the middle of the Thistle a lot and is responsible for a lot of the control lines, you know, again, as they've said, the outhaul is very general, and kind of how I play the boom bang and then the Cunningham, that's the order I focus on them. It's funny, but I play the boom bang kind of by sound almost, and if I feel like my skipper's back there is easing and much and then having to trim back in, you hear the click of the main sheet ratchet. So there's a lot of times where I feel like I got to pull more boom bang on because we're trying to, you know, that he's easing, maintain control and dump some of the power off. So I want more boom bang on, you know, to flatten the sail out. But then what I'll do is I'll visually watch the overbend. There's a big overbending wrinkle that appears on a lot of the sails from the middle, the lower diamond all the way back to the back of the main vision window. And what I do is I'll pull the boom bang on and you'll see the wrinkle get larger, and it'll end up a lot of times behind the window, and I'll actually use the Cunningham to trim out that overbend wrinkle until it's, you know, up above the window again, and not, you know, that means to me you know, that I'm pulling the draft forward, especially in the bottom of the sail. So it's kind of a sound thing with the boom bang and a feel thing because I've been doing it for so long. But, you know, the Cunningham's definitely visual. You're looking at the main, and the Thistle mains are nice because they have a really obvious overbend wrinkle that happens. You got the sails, mast is super bendy, so you can kind of see it. So that's my crew tip for boom banging. Then we'll move on to the next topic, and that's gearing up. So ultimately, you know, adjusting the gross trim of the sails, the jib sheets and the main sheet, and, you know, obviously the spinnaker sheet if you're going down, and it's kind of like shifting through the gears of a car. You're going to start and stop, then you want to accelerate, and you want to get to a point where you're going as fast as possible. Then there's a balance between you want to go fast, but you want to point high, and then there's heavy air mode. So I'm going to kick this one over to Allan and let him talk a little bit and really focus on, you know, the Thistle does a great job in accelerating, so I'm going to talk to Allan on what he feels like the primary modes are in the Thistle when he's going upwind.
Yeah, I mean, it's I mean, I don't know if I necessarily think of it as gears as much as, I mean, for me, the whole primary thing with a Thistle is it's got a round bottom and it's got fairly small blades. So my whole goal is to keep the boat flat. And, you know, you're really doing everything you can based off of that. So, I mean, I know the one thing for the jib is, you know, when you're looking at jib trim is I've always felt, you know, if the jib's just touching the rail or a little, you know, maybe a touch inside of it, but pretty rare. But, you know, if the jib's touching the rail, you're in a pretty good mode most of the time. And then whether you're in a pointing or kind of depends on the main. If you're going to, you know, sail inside the jib, you're just going to trim the main a little harder and put the bow up. If you're trying to lay on the jib and go fast, you probably have to ease the main so you don't go over. So it's kind of one of those things, you know, believe it or not, when we're, you know, sailing the boat a lot and really working on it, you know, one of the things we actually came back to was, you know, a little bit of less was more with the jib sheet. And we were really adjusting the jib sheet basing off of, you know, how much wind speed there was and if it was pushing the jib into the rail or not. So if a puff would come and, you know, it would, you know, you could see the jib, like, because it's, you know, Dacron sail, they move a little bit. You know, would lay against the rail, we would come in, and then if it went up and you would see the sail kind of, you know, release pressure and kind of come inside the rail, we were easing. And I don't think it was as much of a whether we're footing pointing mode on the jib. I think the rest of that was really, you know, on the main and what we had to do to keep the boat flat. And for me, it's about keeping the boat as flat as possible and then just kind of steering and setting the main up to that. And honestly, the jib didn't move as much for that as much as the main and steering did. So to me, that was really the big thing. You know, when they look at the jib in terms of all these things, whether you're in a pinch mode, point mode, even acceleration mode, you know, the one thing to remember is getting your jib cars and the halyard set up, you know, close to what you wanted, which for me was always, you know, have the luff of the jib just smooth. And the jib car in a way where the you know, top and the bottom of the sail broke really evenly, which most times was the car almost, you know, pretty far back on the track, believe it or not. And it went from there. You know, the only time the jib might have been eased a little bit is if we came out of a tack. I always said make sure the jib was eased an inch or so, just so we wouldn't tip over while everyone was trying to get in the straps. But as soon as we were going again, it was, you know, just inside the rail, and that's really what we focused on. And then really the main was everything off of that, just to keep the boat flat and going. So, that was the way we normally set the boat up for that stuff. I'm curious to hear if Greg's a little different. You know, for us, it was more of a, you know, we sailed smaller maybe than other people, but it was always keep the boat flat, hike as hard as we can. And, you know, it was more of a main sheet driven operation than jib and even the controls to me were kind of a course adjustment when we needed it, other than the vang and the main sheet. So I'd be curious to hear Greg's thoughts.
Yeah, I agree totally with that. And actually, if you look at this is a photo in the yep. slide from the old boat a couple years ago, and it was blowing pretty hard that year. And you can see there's pretty good lump in the lake there. And so we're having power through some chop, but if you look how flat, we're only two man. And you can see a big bow wave there, and the boat is powered up. Look at the jib, it's right on the rail, just as Allan described. We're not adjusting the jib a whole lot, except if it's a big puff, Mark might ease it just a little bit. But what you do is you set it up a little bit looser, which allows me, look at the angle on the main sheet there. We're vang sheeted, we've got a tight outhaul, you can see that tight shelf closed, and then the main is way out, that's almost 45 degrees. So it's almost to the side of the boat. It's probably, you know, a few inches from the side of the boat, but we've got plenty of height because we're powered up. We're not having to fight for height, but we're trying to achieve maximum flow over the foils, which then makes the boat point. And Allan just hit all of that perfectly. And you can see the representation right there in that picture.
Yep.
Mark would tell me I'm sitting in the lounge chair back there, not even hiking while he's hiking, I'm sure. But
the reason Mark's hiking is because he saw the photo boat.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, the photo boat. He hikes hard.
So it sounds like you guys, the big thing you focus on is going fast first and letting the flat boat and the blades in the neutral helm kind of get you into that point mode, and then once you're at top speed, you can work the boat a little harder then, correct?
Well, I mean, yeah, for sure, and some of it depends on the breeze. I mean, in under 10 knots, if you're tacking properly, the boat's almost faster out of a tack than sailing normally. So, really, to me, it's about getting them settled and then just deciding kind of what your course mode is. If you're, you know, if you think the next shift is a header, you might start footing pretty hard to get to it. You know, if you think you're going to be, you know, it kind of depends on if you want to be bow up, bow down mode and really set the boat up for that. I really feel like once the boat is flat and you have, you know, some flow, which again, if you tack well or you're coming out of transitions okay, it's not that long of a period. So I think, you know, one of the big, to me, misconceptions with the Thistle is oh, you got to put the bow down and gumbling. It's like, no, you just got to get the boat flat and get it moving, which doesn't take that long. Very rarely I've seen guys in Thistles go in a really like long extended bow down speed mode or whatever you want to call it and gain. It's usually once you get the boat going at a reasonable clip, then you see everyone trying to work the boat flat and keep the boat up versus, you know, the guys who are the quote unquote footers. Generally over the long period, they lose a lot. I mean, that's always been my feel. So it's really just get the boat flat and get it trucking, and then you're working the main and working your height as you can. Kind of dependent on the sea state. I think that's really the big thing. And you're like just on the edge of stalling, bow up just till it stalls, and then you bow down enough to keep the flow, and then it's flows back on, bow up enough just on the edge of stalling, and then bow down again to keep it going. I think that's, if you look at the top boats, and I know Greg's better than that than 99.9% of the people out there, that's how they're getting upwind fastest. They're just, once they get going, try and get the bow up as high as they can until it's just about to stall, and then they get going again. And it's the get going again is maybe a degree of bow down, and they ease the main sheet and they go for 30 seconds and then they're right back at it. So that's to me kind of the big thing. It's very main sheet driving dependent, and the crews who hike the hardest.
Add to that the definition of flat. You know, people think they're flat a lot of times, and their field like 7 degrees or 5 degrees flat. You're looking at like 2 degrees or less. And when the boat is flat, the helm feels horrible to the skipper because it feels like it's trying to come back to windward of, and it's because the helm is neutral, and that's what you want. It's totally balanced.
Agree.
All right, thanks, guys. We'll move on to our next topic. And here we start, obviously, with starting. That's where it all begins, ultimately, on the race course. And so the first thing we want to talk about when the start is actually the pre-start. It's very important to do your homework before the start, because a lot of, you know, starting, in my mind, is 50 to 75% of the race because it puts you in a good position. It puts you where you need to be on the race course, and it puts you out in front of a good majority of your competition if you have a good start. Some of the key points for starting are to get out early and identifying any wind paths. You know, obviously adjust your lines to their general settings to maximize your speed and height. And the other important thing is to also identify which end of the line is favored. And so I've sailed with Greg multiple times, and I know he does a lot of homework before his starts. So Greg, just go ahead and talk about, you know, kind of what you look for before the start, and even, you know, how early would you prefer to get out to the race course if everything fell into place?
Yeah, thanks, Karl. I actually had a great, it was a great example this past weekend. We were sailing in Savannah, which I've only sailed there like 4 times, maybe 3 times, something like that. And so it was a different venue for us. And we had a youth sailor sailing with the little linebacker, and we want to get him a little bit of time as well. So I would say, you think about other sports, organized sports, and you think about how much time you spend practicing, the ratio of practice to competition, and it's completely opposite of what we do sailing. And I would say the more time you can spend prior, the better. Unless it's just totally nuking and you're wearing yourself out getting out there, getting out an hour before the start is a great idea. It will lead to success. We got a little bit, you know, we were probably left the dock 55 minutes before the start, and we're able to go sail the entire way up to the sailing area and establish what we thought was going to be the game plan. And it was a huge advantage to be able to do that. We knew just which side of the course to get to, and we were able to execute that game plan. So figuring out if there's a current factor, you know, that was the big key in Savannah. It was going to be flooding in the whole time, and so being relieved on the shore and figuring out how close you could get to the shore. And we came up with a game plan prior that we wanted to sail until the centerboard hit the bottom and pull it up a little and tack. And that's what we did the entire time. We sailed as close to the weeds as we could, and we sailed in a little less current more often, and that was a huge advantage. So I think the earlier we can get out, the better.
Feedback, Greg, and then we'll move on. We'll continue the topic of starting, and then we'll move on to, you know, kind of, you know, like Greg said, very unlike other sports, we hours in the water practicing our start. So it's important to get into some type of a routine, get into a starting routine that kind of suits your style and level of competitiveness. You know, and the big thing here is, you know, trying to cross the starting line within 5 seconds after the start, whether you're on the favored end or not. And the goal at the start is to be sailing in clear air at top speed on the favored tack. So, Allan, are there any keys, like, do you have a routine that you settle into on each start, or is it
prior to? I mean, it really depends on, I mean, for me, the one thing is always, you know, it really just depends on where we're trying to start and what we're trying to do. I mean, for me, my one routine is I'm always trying to find space. Anywhere where you can, you know, obviously I want to be towards the favored end, and depending on where you sail, that favored end becomes more crucial. You know, I think in a place like, you know, thinking back on it, you know, places like St. Pete, being at a favored end is much more critical than, you know, sailing at a place like when we sailed the Nationals in Sandusky or San Diego is probably even a little bit more critical to having a favored end start versus sailing in, you know, a lake where, you know, your whole goal on like lake sailing might be just to get on the favored tack as much as you can. So you're willing to give up a few boat lengths here or there, or, you know, or even Jacksonville, the one time I sailed there, it wasn't as critical to win the pin or the boat. It was just get off the line clean. So it kind of depends on that. And for me, in terms of, you know, routine, I know the one thing we do is we make sure we understand how to accelerate in the conditions we're sailing in. So we do a couple of, like, slow the boat down and then get going just to get the timing comfortable. And for me, you know, when it comes to the routine, again, it's just making sure that we kind of feel comfortable with the, you know, as we call it, the musical chairs as the boats are moving around trying to find their spot, and really making sure we're kind of with the flow of boats. And that we always have an escape route. And for me, it's being just open-minded about it and talking to your team about what they do, and that your teammates understand their role. So, you know, the jib trimmers really got to focus on working with the speed, which is with the driver, and the forward crew really has to work hard on timing and talking traffic, and, you know, if they're really good at it, managing distance off the line. I think the top Thistle teams, when it comes to starting, have the bow crew who's really good at judging distance off the line are the ones that get the best. I mean, I know when we sailed, Sam was awesome at telling us how far off the line we were, and there'd be times where we were convinced we were too far punched out, but, you know, just being comfortable with that part of it made a big difference. So, you know, to me, starting is just being open-minded and just trying to find the same goals, which is, and I'm long tack, have enough space to go fast, and then, you know, kind of just work the race from there.
Awesome, Al. Thank you. Yeah, no, that sounds good. And again, like Al said, it's just getting comfortable in your routine and finding something that works for you that puts you in a position to be where your starting line is. All right, so that finishes up our starting. Now we're going to move on to being on the race course. And one of the first things we want to talk about being on the race course, it's kind of a phrase we throw around a lot with a bunch of people that I sail with and against. It's climbing the ladder, so to speak. You know, it's all about the primary goal of the first beat, or any beat for that matter, is trying to minimize your risk while maximizing your reward. And it's pretty much the same concept we were talking about on the starting line carried over to the entire beat. That's sailing in clear air with the highest velocity, you know, trying to sail on the closest angle toward, and sailing with the majority of the fleet. And how do you do that? You know, ultimately you're trying to beat everybody up to the first mark, but how do you do that? Well, you know, one of the things we focus on, and I think about a lot when we're talking about strategy and tactics going upwind, being in a position where we can be leading the majority of the fleet to the next shift. And ultimately what that means is whenever you get the opportunity to sail on a lift attack back towards the middle of the race course, take that opportunity. And more often than not, there are definitely times where it doesn't work and somebody leverages way out to one side and just stays behind. But more often than not, trying to sail up the middle of the beat is the way to go. And you know, I'll kick this over to Greg real quick, because you know, I again have sailed together, and we've actually sailed against each other in a couple events within the last couple of months. You know, Midwinters in St. Pete, Jacksonville, where you know, trying to get back to the middle definitely paid off a lot.
Yeah, I'd say, you know, there's different types of conditions to sail in. You know, if it's not a persistent, you're really going to want to stay toward the middle. It's going to give you more success more often, just because of the chances that you take. By getting to a side, you end up with more of the fleet to one side of you, and then if there is a ship to that side, you could be behind all of those boats that are to another side. So by being in the middle of the course and the fleet, that's the ideal situation, because then if the wind oscillates, usually, you know, we're often sailing in an oscillating or a puff condition, you're going to be able to get pieces of each ship. And so you go over and you sail towards the right side of a beat, and you get a little knock, you want to take that header and then work it back, because you're probably on a nice ship with pressure, and then you work it back towards the next ship coming down. And that's what we typically sail in, as either a puff condition or an oscillating condition. It's very rare that a persistent condition occurs. And even then, you know, if the wind is persisting over, you know, over the time of one race, it's usually only like two or three degrees difference by the time. So I'd say, you know, being conservative and working that middle of the course as much as possible is crucial. And setting up yourself by being in a position to tack onto the favorite tack after the start is you going that right way.
Yeah, thanks, Greg. And I think the big thing is it's sailing upwind is probably a balance between, you know, sailing on the proper angle towards the mark and trying to get to the next puff. And there are times when you may, you know, be sailing on a, you know, an even tack or even a knock tack, trying to get some more pressure. And there are some times where that pressure is just not on the race course, so there's no sense in even chasing it. So I think it's a balance. And again, it's all about, you know, relative to where you are to the mark and the rest of the fleet. So that kind of makes sense. And then we'll move on, you know, we'll move on to our next topic, which is, you know, once you get up the beat, you had a successful beat, you round the mark, and now what you got to do is try and get to the leeward mark or the reaching mark as fast as possible. And I know, you know, Al is very, very fast downwind. I think his team did a great job of looking around for breeze and communicating on what's going on. You know, and to me, the biggest thing about sailing downwind is really that I'd say the same thing all the time. It's about going lower faster. And, you know, some of the stuff you can look at, it's a lot of crew driven. You know, I think downwind is where a lot of the teamwork comes in, primarily on the runs and the reaches. You know, with the crew looking around for the breeze, your maneuvers have to be on point when you're jibing. And the crew work flying the spinnaker needs to be in sync with what the skipper is trying to do in regards to the pole height, in regards to how deep or how high you want to sail. and then, you know, you know, ultimately the heel of the boat, cruise placement, etc. So, Al, we've got two slides here. The first slide talks a little bit about running. And the second slide is going to talk about reaching. So if you can just touch on those very briefly, great.
Yeah, I mean, I think you've covered a lot of it. I mean, I think that the deal with going downwind is remembering that, you know, the goal is to be in the breeze as much as you can, finding the puffs. And you know, when you're going downwind, you're going with the breeze. So you tend to stay in puffs longer, whereas upwind, you're passing them. So, you know, you hit a puff and you're going through it and it's going the other way. So you go through them quickly. Whereas downwind, if you get into a good puff, you know, it's really, you know, important to do that. And, you know, the two things we always focus on is which jibe is closest to the mark, which one puts us in a clean lane, and which one, you know, puts us in the most breeze. And, you know, we just try to balance those three things as much as we can. And that's really the key to, you know, getting down the runs efficiently. And in terms of sailing the boat, you know, I think the one thing is the board angle is really crucial. And I think getting the board up as much as you can take without the boat feeling like it's sliding out from under your butt is important. I think you need just enough board to keep the boat going straight. I mean, I know there's some people who sail downwind with the board all the way down. I mean, there's some people who sail with it all the way up. You know, I kind of felt like our good mode was up to the point where the boat was still stable and going straight, but not like, you know, sloshing around like a you know, side to side and rocking all over the place. I think that's really bad. You know, and I think, again, the real crucial part is just finding the breeze, and you're right back to it, is the crew handling on this stuff. I think even more so, more than upwind, downwind is about the crew. I think upwind is really, the boat is very driver-centric in terms of steering and main trim. I think downwind, it's all the forward and middle one, spin trim and boat handling that gets the boat down the course the best. So to me, that's where you saw the top crews really do it was going down the run. Reaching is a kind of a different beach. We can get to that to the next slide.
Allan, before we leave this slide, can we go back to the slide real quick? I just want to, one other thing I feel is really key to everything you just added was spot on.
Yeah.
But the main bail trim is crucial. And just as you talked about the stability of the boat with the centerboard, when you're sailing deep, you want to actually get this top batten perpendicular to the wind as much as possible. So if it's really squirrely, you might not ease the vang quite as much, but because of the way the shrouds are angled back on the thistle, it tends to keep the boom in tighter, so you can't always present as much sail area down low, but you can ease the vang so this top batten and the top part of the sail becomes more perpendicular. You present a little more surface. If you start going really squirrely, you're obviously going to pull that vang back on. It's kind of your safety, just like the board. You can drop the board down just a little bit more. But
that's all. Thanks, Greg. And then Al, real quickly, some pointers on reaching.
I think the thing on reaching, you know, it's kind of it's very much more of a tactical, you know, situation than in you know, other things. But, you know, the one thing we always stressed on was not worrying about the mark, especially on early parts of reaches. It was trying to get the boat to go as fast as you can. And sometimes you got to be careful of, you know, you see guys going early in the leg. They're trying to go up because they think they got to make the mark. And the boat, when it's super tight reaching, it kind of feels like it's being pulled sideways. And you don't know what the wind's going to do. It's going to shift or do things later. So, especially early in reach legs, you know, we really tried to keep the boat so it didn't feel like you were fighting it. And one of the things you put in here, yeah, the pole down a little bit, I think is important. I think the other thing is making sure that, A, the team hikes really hard, and this is where even the driver, it's more important for them to hike more than normal because the middle crew can't hike as hard while they're trimming the kite. But, you know, really just keeping the boat on its feet and sliding back a little bit to get the knuckle of the bow just out of the water. But the whole thing is to kind of keep the boat under the spinnaker, so to speak, and let the boat be as free as possible. You know, the boat, you know, in my opinion, it's a really good reaching boat because it's on the bottom. But it's really about finding the balance so the boat is released and it's sailing freely. And doesn't have too much load on the helm or the board or the spinnaker and getting the boat out of balance. So you're just trying to have the board height, you know, the angle, the spin trim, and the basically the rudder load to be even enough that the boat will accelerate, which is easier said than done, and it's a lot of experimenting. But there's a lot of reward to, if you get the boat to reach properly, you gain a lot. And I think the one big mistake to make is not over trimming the kite when you're reaching. You want to carry some curl, as much curl as you can take on the reach, because that lets the boat be as free as it can be. I'm sure Greg has a few things to throw too, but.
The two things I would add feed right into what you're saying about freeing the boat up, and we'll have the forward crew. You can see this picture, we're actually all spread out because the forward crew has just made the pole and they're hooking the guy hook in. So I'm slid back to do just what you're saying, which is to get that knuckle up. And you can see we're pretty oriented properly. And then as they come back, I'll close back up to Mark there in the middle, and we'll be all together. If we're on a tight reach, if we're not, if it's not as quite as tight, that forward crew is going to sit down here on the low side. But you try and get the boat as stable as possible, and then they're going to play the centerboard to free that helm up. So we may have it a little lower if I feel like we're sliding out too much, or if we're planing and we're tracking on the rudder really well, we're going to actually pull the board up and allow it to free up and skate out a little bit. So the board and the main, you notice the bang's kind of looser on this setup because you don't need to have the top of the sail. All that's doing is create a heeling moment. You can spill that little bit off up there and it makes the boat much easier to trim and sail. And those were kind of epiphanies for me of, you know, I need to hang real tight on the reach, but you really don't have to have it super tight. You can be spilling a little bit off there.
Awesome. Thanks, Greg and Al. And we're running a little short on time here at the end, so we're just going to move forward and talk really briefly, about the some boat handling. And, you know, a lot of boat handling is about feel, making sure the helm is neutral, you know, hiking as hard as you can to keep the boat flat and doing any type of sail adjustments. Make sure you're tacking in the flat spots. And, you know, if you're sailing in big breeze and you're going downwind, make sure you're jibing when the boat is going as fast as possible. So if you guys got any quick pointers, we're going upwind, Greg, maybe you can add a little bit here. And ultimately, I think one of the big things, I did see somebody ask a question, if I answer it right here, is, how do you tack as fast as possible?
I'll take that one, Carl, because it's actually counterintuitive when you think tacking that you turn the boat quickly, but especially when you're in flat water, you're going to turn the boat toward the wind quite slowly. And I always describe, you know, as you push the tiller away, it only starts a couple inches, and then you gradually increase the amount that the tiller is angled toward that rail, that lee rail. And then everybody rolls to pull the mast over, and the whole goal there is to get the attitude of the boat coming out of the tack so that you can then come across without flattening too quickly and get your foils working faster, not just the foils above the water, but the foils below. And when you get that nice finesse flatten out of the tack, it's really the payoff on a good roll tack. So it's kind of a gradually increasing. I'd say the biggest mistake that's made is to turn the boat too quick initially. You can turn it quite slowly and gain distance to weather, especially if it's not super lumpy. Now, if it's huge St. Pete chop, you might have to turn a little quicker to get the bow through the wave and not stall it. But then again, we're going to be looking for those flattest spots we can find. We don't want to tack in the biggest set of three waves or whatever.
Yeah, I mean, I fully agree with that. And the one thing I was going to say is I think the biggest thing to this, Carl, honestly, is the teams that practice and do the dance together well are the ones that do it. I mean, everybody tacks and does things a little differently, but the teams that really get the footwork, and believe it or not, I would say in a Thistle, more than a lot of other boats, it's there's a lot of footwork to tacking and keeping your feet under you and knowing where to push off and how to climb across the boat, because it's like, especially for the crews, it's like a jungle to get under the boom. Getting that dance down, the teams do that are the ones that really excel when it comes to tacking, jibing, and those maneuvers. And, you know, you can tell the teams that go out and put time in, they're way ahead. And you know, everybody does it a little differently, but even if they do it the same every time and they do it like 90% every time, they're way ahead. I mean, way, way, way ahead. I think that's the biggest thing on boat handling for me. This boat really rewards teams that are choreographed well.
Yeah, no, I would agree. It almost becomes second nature where you're out there on the race course and all of a sudden all you notice are the bad tacks. If it's a good tack, you just forward and on. You don't really notice. All right, well, thank you, guys. We're going to go ahead and present everybody's contact information. We're running a little short on time. If anybody has any questions, feel free to type them in the chat window and we'll answer them. But ultimately, you know, I want to thank Allan and Greg for joining me. We've had long conversations over the last couple months on, you know, what we can do back to contribute more and more to the Thistle class. So I'd like to thank them for giving me, you know, the time from both of them to contribute to this webcast. Again, anybody shared, a link will be sent to you with a recording of the webcast, so you can do it at your leisure. And we also have a follow-up webcast that will be June 1st at noon, and that's going to talk a little bit more in-depth regarding sail construction and design in the Thistle, kind of what concepts are out there and really what we have done over the past couple of years, improve the performance and durability of our shapes and our construction. So, again, if anybody has any questions, you can reach out to myself or Allan or Greg directly. We'll try and answer them as best as we can. See us on the race course, pull us aside, ask us anything you have, and happy to help.
Thanks for having me, Carl.
Thanks, Greg. Thanks, Al.
Yeah, thanks, Carl. Don't forget, you know, for the guys in the West Coast, that Mike Gillum is also an on-the-circuit rep. And George Zabo and Mark Reynolds are also available to help them for the guys on the West Coast, too. So we have Thistle folks everywhere available to help.